Good morning, church. Great to see some smiling faces. And if you're watching online this morning, I thank you for joining us, and I hope you'll be blessed by all that goes on. We're going to push straight into a time of worship this morning. Can I ask you, if you're able, to stand, and we're going to worship God together. Father, we thank you that when we gather, that you are present also. And so we acknowledge your presence amongst us this morning, Lord. And we say thank you. Thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your promises over our lives. Thank you for all the hope that we have in you. And Lord, Father, we bless you this morning. We bless you, Lord God. Ben.
The Lamb that was slain, the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. Oh, bow before Him. Worship You, Jesus. We worship You. Now God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. And our God is the Lamb. He's the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain. And every knee bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. Bow before You. Bow before You, Jesus. Oh, we bow before You. Our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. How wonderful You are. Oh, receive it, Lord. Receive our adoration. Jesus, Lamb of God, You're worthy of it all. Receive our adoration. How wonderful You are. We bow our hearts, we lift our hands, we turn our eyes. Surrender to the truth that all we need is found in You. Receive our adoration, O Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. How wonderful You are. We choose to leave it all behind and turn our eyes towards the prize, the upward call of God in Christ. You have our hearts, Lord, take our life. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. Oh, how wonderful You are. Receive it all. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. How wonderful You are. We saw You say, everything You've made resounds. All creation standing now, lifting up Your name. And we're caught up in the angels' song. We're gathered. gather to your ancient throne, children in our Father's arms, shouting out your praise. Every soul and every soul you save sings out as everything you've made resounds, and all creation standing now, we're lifting up your name. We're caught up in the angels' song. We're gathered to your ancient throne, children in our Father's arms. Oh, we're shouting out your praise. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. Oh, how wonderful you are. Oh, receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. You're worthy. Receive our adoration. How wonderful you are. Receive our adoration, Jesus, Lamb of God. Receive our adoration. Oh, how wonderful. How wonderful you are. How wonderful you are. We worship you, Jesus. How wonderful, how beautiful you are. So worthy of it all, because you're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you are all things. You deserve the glory, and you're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you are all things. Lord, you deserve the glory. Just you're worthy, Lord, and you're worthy of it all. And you're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Blood and righteousness.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. It's in Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. And through the storm, He is Lord, He is Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Oh, when Christ
Lord, we worship you.
down and worship Him. Worship Him. No worship Him. Oh, come and bow down and worship Him. Oh, worship Him. Oh, worship Him. Oh, and bow down and worship Him. Come and worship Him. No worship Him.
Oh, Lord. We come now to our time of remembrance this morning. We'd like to sit down for just a moment. This is traditional. We do this in this country across the churches on this Sunday. But I just want to say we don't do it as a nationalistic thing. This isn't about our country, about the United Kingdom. That's not what it's about. And we don't do it as a militaristic thing. We don't glorify war. War is horrendous. War is always the result somewhere along the line of human sin. So we don't celebrate war. But we do this to honour, to remember those who have fought, those who have been caught up in the horror of war. We remember those who have served their country for causes they believe to be just. We remember those who've lost their lives, those who've been scarred physically, mentally, and we remember those who've lost loved ones whose lives have been changed forever through war. So it may be you have a personal connection through generations past or through conflicts going on today. You may have a personal connection, and it's good to have time to remember and to honour those close to you. For some of us, there may be no personal connection, but there may be others we know that this affects them, this means something to them. We can reflect on war and on courage and sacrifice, and we can pray today for those for whom this is hard. We can pray for those who are suffering today. So we're going to stand. We'll just have a minute or two of silence, and then I'll just lead us in prayer. So would you like to stand now, and we can remember, we can think of those we know, we can reflect, and we can pray. Let's be silent, shall we? Father, we pray today for those who live now in the pain, in the suffering, in the grief, in the loss of war, past and present. Father, we pray for those affected today. Father, we're very conscious of what's going on in Ukraine. Lord, we lift that land before you. Father, we pray wherever there is suffering, wherever there is loss and pain, we pray that you will bring comfort. You will give strength. You will grant endurance and perseverance, the strength to carry on. Father, we pray you will help those who are weak and who suffer today. We ask that in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for our world where there is war at this time. Think of Ukraine, Myanmar, Yemen, many other places in this world where there's conflict right now. Father, you are the God who makes wars cease in all the world. It's what your word says. Father, we know that the fulfillment of that is still to come, but we pray in our day that you will oppose injustice and greed and oppression and evil. Wherever the hearts of men are twisted, that war is the result. Father, we pray you bring that to an end in Jesus' name. Father, we pray in your world, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we thank you for the example of those who have served, who have fought with courage and with sacrifice. And Lord, we pray that we too may be willing to serve, willing to lay down our lives in the battle in which we are engaged in your name. to rescue men and women from sin and from slavery and from darkness, to rescue them from the dominion of darkness, to set them free that they may come into your wonderful light. Father, we pray that wherever you place us, we may serve faithfully. Lord, all these things we ask in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Thanks, Jules. Well, as it wouldn't be a Sunday morning without a few notices, and I'll just say the first one is, most of the things that we say are already in this, so if you haven't picked up one of these, if you haven't read one of these, if you haven't given one of these away, then can I encourage you to do so? This is a KCO magazine for this term. It's got all the dates and everything else that are going on, and I encourage you to look at that. A few notices. What's the first one, Jenny? Ah, clothes swap. I don't know a lot about this, but some of you do. Ladies' event next Friday, 7:45. Tickets are available online, book through Church Suite. Encourage you to get involved. It'll be a fun time just gathering together, ladies. Any information, speak to Jane or one of the team. And yeah, let me just encourage you to book in for that. Next one, Jen. Oh, yeah, a fun pub carols night. I think a lot of the tickets are going, so you need to be fast on this. If anyone hasn't been to this before, it's a night where we gather, have a few, sing carols together, have table games, a bit of fun. There's food, and it's just a great way to invite somebody who maybe would never come into a church building, to get them to come along, see what we're about, experience the family of God having fun together. Encourage you to get your tickets, and I think there are some left, but it is going really fast. So 2nd of December, it's on the Friday the 2nd because of the football fixtures, in case you're wondering. Okay, next one. Right, Christmas lunch hampers. I think there's a hamperometer just outside the door on the left on the notice board. I think we're intending to give away 220 hampers within the community to those who really are in need. We're up to about 90 so far. 19 hampers have been donated funds-wise, so we need to keep going, church. If you haven't got involved in this before, £35 buys enough stuff for a Christmas hamper to feed a family, and it's just a really great way of us as the church blessing those in the locality who are going to be without this Christmas. The need is massive. Our referral partners, we don't choose who gets them. It's the local partners within the community, people like Citizens Advice, the food banks, the county council. They're the ones who recommend these families to us, and then we're able to gift them something from the Lord. So it's a great thing. You'll get more chance to be involved packing and delivering and all that kind of stuff, but we need some more funds for it. So church, let me encourage you, if you fancy giving another one away, then do that. And Carl, who's going to be sharing with us a few moments, is here with us today, and we're really blessed to have Carl, and he'll explain a little bit about what he does and who he is in a little while. But don't forget, guys, check in tonight. I think there's about 70 of us so far. More will be welcome. We're going to gather, encourage one another, and gather with one another tonight. So that's that. I have one last notice. Abs. And I'm going to let Abby give this notice. You're on, Abs.
Thank you very much. So we've got lots of fun events coming up at Christmas, but one that we really want to point out today is on the 18th of December, we're having our family Christmas celebration. So through the year, we've had lots of different community events. We had a big event for Easter. We've had obviously the Holiday Club, where we had a few hundred children, and more recently, Saints and Superheroes, where we had a couple of hundred families come along. And it's been amazing to kind of build up those connections. They really trust us, and it seems that a lot of people seem to come whenever we put anything out there. So it's also an incredible opportunity for us just to share our faith in each of those key moments throughout the year. So we're thinking Christmas is also just a brilliant time to do that. So you might imagine our family service in previous years have been kind of chairs out, quite formal, trying to keep the children quiet. Forget that. We're going to do it completely differently this year. Think a little bit like big day out inside, but Christmassy, or Saints and Superheroes. We're going to clear all the chairs, open up the church, just welcome the community. We're going to have pastries, cafe. We're getting a live nativity with real animals outside. A carousel, hopefully. Yeah, and it'll just be a lot of fun, activities, families can come along. We're going to invite the football club and also those that are getting the hampers. We thought that would be brilliant if we could invite them along as well. So obviously we can't really do that on our own as a staff team. So we wanted just to say today, it'd be amazing if you could put that date in your diary. And we'd love it if you could come with your family, invite friends, or just come and serve if you're able to. So you can sign up today. I think Adrian and Fizzy will be at the back. So you can have a chat with them on your way out. I think that's it.
Great. Thanks, Sebs. Let's take a moment to chat to those around us, shall we? Greet one another, encourage one another, smile at one another, all those lovely things. Okay. Well, let me encourage you to continue those conversations after the service this morning. But right now, it's let me introduce to you Carl. Carl, do you want to come up, mate? Some of you will, if you followed Code Life, if you've been part of the gathering, if you're part of CVM or have been involved over the years with CVM, you'll know Carl and his ministry. And Carl has pioneered ministries across the nation, particularly focused on men and the poor. And it's a real privilege to have him with us this morning. And it's going to be an encouragement. But why don't we encourage him by praying for him this morning? Father, we thank you for this man. We thank you for the call upon his life. We thank you, Father God, for the way you are using him in this day. And Lord, would you open our ears and eyes this morning that we might hear what God is saying through him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much, Paul. Good morning, everybody. It's really good to be with you. Let me give you a little bit of a wider introduction to who I am. So as you can tell from my dulcet tones, I was born in Dagenham. That normally gets a cheer, or is someone clapped. Do you come from Dagenham?
No.
Oh, so, well, we prefer to call it Dagenham, actually, because it sounds a little bit more sophisticated. So I'm come from Dagenham. As my dad got promoted in the Met Police, he was a detective. He was an armed flying squad detective, actually. And then was in the regional crime squad and the murder squad. As he got promoted, we moved further up the A12. So I ended up in the dizzy heights of Hornchurch, Romford, and then Brentwood. So I feel quite at home here, let's just say that. So that's us. I am married to Karen. I'm going to tell a bit more of my story tonight to the fellas. We've been married for 28 years, been together for 32 years. I met her in church. I wasn't a Christian. I got invited by a mate and I saw a good looking girl. So I asked her out that night, actually. I said, I think I'll be very good for you. Let me take you out to the Deep Pan Pizza Factory in Romford. I know how to treat a lady.
And she said, no, I only go out with Christians. I said, I am one. I'm British. But she, a true story, but she saw through me. So I actually researched how people become Christians, and I faked being Cliff Richard the next week. Said I met the Lord. She still declined. 6 months later, gave me life to Christ. We ended up together. And we are now with two adult daughters. I've got one who is just about to finish, praise the Lord, because it's phenomenally expensive, training to be a vet in Royal Veterinary College only a few months ago, praise the Lord. And I've got another one who's a tattoo artist. How does that even happen? You bring them both up the same. You put the same values in, the same everything, and one's a super academic and the other one lives in Narnia. How does that happen? So that's me. I've also got a dog. I did have a German Shepherd. I've now got a Cavapoo. That thinks it's a wolf, but I haven't told it it's 75% toy poodle. I don't want to crush it. I've got a tortoise called Gary, dog called Douglas, and a cat called Spencer. And I live in a place called Staveley. There are two Staveleys in the UK. There is one in the Lake District with rolling hills and beautiful lakes and clotted cream tea shops. And there's one that's an ex-battered mining community in Derbyshire. I'll let you guess which one I live in. So I live in Staveley, where I'm pioneering submission. On a serious note, the community... So we run Edge Ministries, some rescue centres in our HQ in areas of super deprivation. There's like 38,500 council wards. We work in sort of the bottom 1,500. So that's where I live, where I work, and where we're running a network of churches around the country focused on planting and establishing ministry in the most forgotten places. So to put it in context, just to give you to widen your aperture, so to speak, there are 20,000 people living in Staveley. When we got there, there were less than 60 people going to evangelical churches. 45% of people are illiterate, 33% of kids are under the poverty line, and we set our hearts to move there and make the rest of our lives there, and to pioneer mission amongst broken people. So I said to Paul when I got here, I'm only good at three things really these days. I did have a wider ministry at one point, but I'm only really good at talking about Jesus, the poor, or to blokes. Outside of that, I'm honestly phenomenally rubbish. So that's me focus. I'm a three-trick pony. So I'm going to deliver one of those ponies today. Suffice to say, for me, everything is about Christ. I'm known for men's ministry. You know, I did many years of men's ministry. I'm still involved in that. Me and Simon dabbling that a little bit together. I run a thing called The Gathering, which has seen over 1,000 or 1,300 blokes come to Christ. Now, it's all great stuff. In fact, it can be quite interesting. I was once introduced at the Big Top in New Wyners. This is Carl Beech. He has a huge passion for men. Let me tell you, that can actually be quite awkward at times in certain circles. But what I have seen since age 18, and I'm now, this is going to shock you, nearly 51. I know you're thinking, how can this be? How can you have such old daughters? It's the joy of the Lord and a clean conscience. That's what keeps you looking youthful. I've seen the power of Jesus changing lives in a most phenomenal way. A few years ago, I was in Belfast. I love Belfast. I love a Belfast... What?
That's good to hear.
Come from Dagenham? Does anyone else get heckled? I get this everywhere. Everywhere I go, I seem to have like a heckle style. It's really odd. Anyway, I mean, keep it going. I like it. I do like a bit of bants. So I was in Belfast a few years back, and I found myself in this little living room, two blokes and me. And one of them was an ex-provisional IRA terrorist. And the other one had been in what was formerly known as the RUC, as a detective, a counter-terrorist detective. And they're sitting there in this living room together, having a brew and a bit of fruitcake. And one of them said, Beachy, which is what most people call me, apart from my mum, Beachy, we used to hunt each other on the streets of Belfast. And now we pray together I'm like, wow. I said, why did you pray it again? He goes, because I'm on the men's breakfast planning committee. But I'm like, wow. Only Jesus, right? Like, only Jesus can do that. I've had the privilege of just travelling around and witnessing this like amazing reconciliation and changed hearts. One time, my wife, Karen, she's not like a Karen. She's a really gentle Karen, actually. It's such an injustice. She's like the most peaceful person you'd ever meet. Anyway, Karen used to be my PA many years ago. I mean, that's an interesting ride, that. Like, when your wife's your PA. So, she had sent me away to the Netherlands for 10 days. You sort of think, am I in a doghouse? And I just didn't. She's just not into confrontation. You just get sent away. So I'm in the Netherlands for 10 days. And then I got back to Schiphol Airport. And in my diary on my phone was to go and speak at a place called Barrow-on-Soar that night. So I'm flying back from Schiphol to East Midlands Airport, where I live near Chesterfield, or Ches Vegas, as we prefer to call it. And I'm looking at my door and think, I've got to get home. I've got like an hour to turn myself around. Has anyone ever heard of Barrow-on-Soar? Why? What? I don't think I want to know. Anyway, so I'm just like, why? So I fly home and I'm a bit grumpy. I know it's hard for you to believe. I'm generally speaking a man full of joy. I said, Karen, why am I going to Barrow-on-Soar? So it was a power move. She said, I felt the Lord wanted you to go as I prayed about it. It was a last minute booking. I thought, that is so high and mighty. How can you argue against that? So anyway, I had a quick shower, turned myself around and drove down to Barrow-on-Soar for what was a curry night for the guys. After I've been away for 10 days, curry is the new quiche in Christendom. You get curry everywhere. I'm sick of it. I mean, let's do something else. Let's forget the curry. Let's move on. It's a new couple of decades. Oh, goodness sake. Fed up with it. So I'm driving down there and I turn up. I'm always early for everything. And when I turn up, the organiser's there. I said, hello, mate. He said, oh, hello, BG. I said, how many people you got coming tonight? He said, we can only fit 25 here, might have 20. I went, all right. He said, what do you want me to do? He said, preach the gospel. I went, fantastic, I can do that. I said, how long have I got? He said, 10, 15 minutes. 10, 15 minutes? Just come back from the Netherlands. Didn't say that, just kept smiling. And then I said, how many people you got going who aren't Christians? He said, I think they're all saved. I went, what do you want to preach the gospel for then? So I'm trying to redeem this situation. And I said, what's on the menu? And he went, chicken booner and a naan bread. I said, what if you don't like chicken booner? And he went, you have a naan bread. So that's what happened. So I'm sitting there and I'm grumpy. And then long story short, me mate Paul Gask comes in. You must meet Gasky one day. He's a phenomenal member of Christian Vision for Men. He's an ex counter-terrorism vice squad detective, actually. And at the time, he was working for the Home Office. And he looks like a pit bull who swallowed a wasp. He really does. And he's very effervescent. And he came in and he sat down opposite me and he was followed by a bloke who looked like a Bond villain. I've actually got the photos on my phone if you want to challenge me on this. I'll happily show you after. This bloke came in looking like you know, like that Jaws bloke, but bald, you know, of a Bond film. And he sat down in front of me with Gasky. I went, hello, mate. And he just went, I went, great. So anyway, they had me naan bread and stood up and I gave a 10-minute talk. This is Jesus. This is the cross. He died for you. He rose again. That's it. Job done. 10 minutes. Sat down. Obedient to time. I normally am. And I sat down and I went to the bloke. What do you think of the talk? He said, fantastic. So I jumped up, thought I'd have a quick half a Diet Coke before I drive back home. And this bloke followed me. He's a big unit. He's about 6'3". Big guy. I'm 5'8.5". The half is significantly important to me. And he looks looking over me and he went, you're Jesus. You're Jesus. That's interesting. You're Jesus. Can he forgive anybody? And I went, yes. He went, how does he do that? And I went, didn't you listen to what I said? And he went, can Jesus forgive a Nazi? gas Jews to death. I went, of course he can. Of course he can. He went, how? And I went, I said to you, didn't you listen? This is how. I gave him a quick run through again, a couple of minutes, and he span on his heel and he walked out the curry house. Gasky comes bounding over, very effervescent character. He goes, he went in front of everyone, little curry house. Significant, he went, very significant, significant. That is a very significant conversation, that. Significant. I went, what is significant? And he went, he's a general in a neo-Nazi terrorist unit and he's currently living in a safe house in Barrow-on-Soar. Apparently, that's where the safe houses were until I started talking about it. But anyway, I said to him, you could have told me that before I got in his face. Anyway, turns out the next morning, this guy who was a terrorist, who's been debriefed by the Home Office, who'd been arrested at gunpoint, planting a pipe bomb at a Pride rally. Turns out the next morning, he goes out, and he's prowling the streets on Barrow-on-Soar early. Barrow-on-Soar's got a canal, curry house, a pub and a Baptist church. A few houses. Sees the lights on in the Baptist church. And he walks in. The Baptist minister's in there, unbelievably, doing his word for today or whatever it was. Imagine this. You're the Baptist leader in sleepy Barrow-on-Soar. And suddenly this hulking, menacing bloke comes in. Stood behind you and went, I heard the message of Jesus last night. Is it true? Thankfully, he was a proper pastor and he knew the gospel and he said it is and he led him to Christ there and then. Guy gets on his knees. Unbelievably, apparently, so he tells me now, overcome by the presence of God. Within 18 months, he preached the gospel on Holocaust Memorial Day to 1,500 people. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. He came to the gathering. I've got a photo of him kneeling at the front with people, praying with a black guy that he'd led to Christ. Now, I'm saying a black guy because he sent a rifle bullet to every significant black media personality that was around, threatening to kill him. That was a transformation. And let me tell you that no self-help book, no CD of self-hypnosis will change your thoughts and your destiny like the gospel of Jesus Christ. Nothing. I don't care what you say, nothing. It is the most powerful message in the universe. Only the gospel. Only the gospel will change both your life and your destiny. And if the church imbibed that truth and we got on the front foot of Jesus' purposes and we lived it and we let our light shine, we would see transformation all over the place. Jesus said this in John 6, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever be hungry, and no one who believes in me will ever, ever be thirsty again. When we hear these stories, and they are not made up stories or parables. I hate using imperatives. But it's great that we clap. But we should be stamping our feet and jumping up and down and crying for joy because someone who is lost has been found. And it's a demonstration that a guy like me is an ordinary bloke, nothing special about him, from Romford could be saved, and so can a terrorist, and so can your neighbour, Maureen. That everyone can have their life and their destiny change and step into the fullness of what God's got for them. As I said to you, I work in a very, very tough context, but it's beautiful. The people are precious. We call it reaching forgotten people in forgotten places. There are millions of places, people around the UK that have no gospel witness near them at all. And I've just set my heart and mind and my determination to try and unlock that. And often the churches are running towards where there's resource and all that kind of stuff. I'm trying to run at the places where there's no resource and hustle and duck and dive and try and do stuff. We have seen some miracles happen, actually. So we operate three centres now and we're seeing some beautiful things happen. But at the top of my road, I live in this council area. Look, let me tell you a little bit what it's like. If you live 3 miles west of me, you live 10 years longer. And you live 30 years longer without chronic health problems. By the time in my community you're hitting 50, you might have some serious snags. We've got the highest incidences of autism in the country. And some of the highest incidences of additional needs because partly there is a place called Staveley Works. And Staveley Works was chemicals, bricks and coking. They used to set an alarm off as recently as 2016 when the chemical cloud came out of the sky to get the kids in out of the playground. I mean, it's diabolical. And they just put up with it. And the pharmaceutical company dealt in benzenes, PCBs. And PCBs are one of the most primary causes of rare cancer, heart defects and autism. The community is decimated. If I could show you the parade of shops, it looks like something out of Haiti. I mean, it's honestly battered and forgotten and overlooked. And they pay more council tax than the people who live 3 miles west. And they get less spent on education and health. These communities are beset by injustice. I'm not standing here as some kind of mad socialist. I just want to bring the gospel to people and help people. So as part of what we do, to bring Christ to people, we've got to help people at their point of need. So it's housing, health, education, drug, alcohol, detox, all that kind of stuff. And it needs people who are determined to live there and live and shine brightly and lead consecrated lives. And holiness and personal holiness is so important living out in these areas. So we set up these rescue centres. We try and hustle and get hold of buildings, which we've been able to by hook or by crook. And we create open living rooms, places of constant welcome and hospitality. Because people don't go into each other's homes. They're quite poor and often they're not very nice. So only family go in and out of each other's homes. Like home groups don't happen because people, A, they don't have big enough living rooms in the low rises and B, they're a bit embarrassed. So we create open living rooms. We run free restaurants and free cafes because people can't afford to eat and heat and sometimes both. 3 out of 4 people, despite existing measures, still can't heat their homes over winter. So people will freeze to death. That is not an exaggeration. Unless we do this, people will freeze to death. And one of my initiatives is Warm Welcome. We've set this thing up across the country. I've got 3,000 venues signed up, libraries, councils, to provide places of hospitality. But we're already doing that. So we have these open living rooms. And in them, you can get housing, benefits, help, you can get all sorts of interventions and support and get a free bit of cake, cup of tea or a free hot lunch and an evening meal. And we have communion meals and all sorts of stuff. This bloke popped down there, 12 doors away from me, never been around my house. I'd seen him shuffling about a bit. He's about 5 years older than me. I found out he was 55, 56 later. And he never looked me in the eye. Never looked me in the eye. And one day he popped into our open living room where we run in housing, benefits and money help. And to cut a long story short, it took a few weeks for me to get eye contact with him and talk to him. It turned out that he'd been 32 years in a parachute regiment and was a sergeant major. This is appropriate for Remembrance Day, I felt, to tell you this story. He'd 32 years in a parachute regiment, he'd been a sniper and a pathfinder, and he was actually part of an elite rescue team. I didn't know these things existed. But apparently they had 4 men units, a few of them. And their job was to fly in a Chinook, which is the double twin rotor helicopter, in the heat of battle and pull out the wounded under fire. So they'd fly them in, they'd jump out the back, they'd sprint under fire and pull the guys out who were wounded who could be saved. He was also been a sniper and all that kind of stuff. So it turned out he had chronic PTSD, combat PTSD. In battle, he was fearless. Years later, we caught up with him. He had survivor guilt and survivor shame. And he was reliving a terror moment where the Chinook pilot had refused to land for good reason, 20 foot up in the air, and his mate, he was watching his mate in the Kajeki minefield. They made a film of it. His mate was lying on the ground, wounded. And my mate Sean is screaming at the pilot to land. And the pilot was refusing because the rate of fire coming down against him was so severe, he wanted to get out of it. And Sean nearly jumped out 20 foot with all his kit on to get to his mate. And as he was leaning out of the Chinook, he watched his mate's body rise up in the air and then go down again. She was laying on a mine. And he watched him get blown up. It turned out he'd been blown up a few times, shot a couple of times, had some shrapnel in him still, had his chronic PTSD, and they hadn't paid out his war pension. So he was in trouble financially. And desperation had got him out of his bedroom, living behind closed curtains. He came down. We were able to help him, actually, through our projects. And we were able to help him get his pension sorted. He's just in that still process now. And that was good. I got talking to him. We run all kinds of projects. Part of what we do is being Jesus' hands and feet every day. We run a community garden. I said, why don't you get involved? He got involved. And then I had a little idea on the 24th of April. I was preaching at a church in Buckinghamshire. So I said, why don't you come with me, fella? We'll truck it down. I've got a truck, man truck. So get in the truck. We'll truck it down to Buckinghamshire. And then I've got some mates who are Christians, but they're mixed martial artists. They're going to do some kung fu stuff and batter each other. But they love the Lord. Come down. And he's like, ugh, all right. So I said, I've got to pick you up at 6. He didn't do mornings. But I managed to get him out, and he cried all the way down. Telling me his story, he cried, he wept over his McDonald's breakfast, he wept all over the truck, he wept in the church, and then we drove down to the mixed martial artists, and in retrospect, I thought, a guy with combat PTSD taking to kung fu is probably not a good idea, but anyway, it was fine. And then he met my mate Clive Elliott, who's a world-leading kung fu guy, and he went over to Sean in this place in Maidstone in Kent, with all these like fellas swilling beer, and like everyone punching each other's lights out. And Clive's a trainer, and he was cornering for a few blokes. And he went, all right, Sean, he said, I heard you were coming. I met Jesus in the dojo on my knees before a fight. The other guy led me to Christ. I went from being a man of violence to a man of peace. Sean's like, aren't you still a man of violence? Anyway, he's like, wow, these guys really mean it. And then we trucked it back, and I dropped him off at 1 a.m. Long story short, he texts me the following morning. He said, I need to come and see you. It's 8:00. I need to come and see you. He said, come over, put the coffee on. We've not had much sleep. And he came over looking a bit shell-shocked. Never been in my house before. That's important. And he said, last night I had a dream. Did you? What was a dream? He said, it's really weird. He said it was vivid. There was a whiteboard standing next to a small chair in a rectangular room, like a hallway or something. And I said, right. And he went, yeah, and on the whiteboard was written, Airborne Soldier, Identity and Injustice. I said, wow. I said, I need to show you something. Because what he didn't know was, 8 weeks earlier, I got up in the morning, like you do, and I was doing my readings, and the Lord spoke to me. It was really weird. I felt the Holy Spirit whispering to my heart, buy a whiteboard. It's the weirdest thing. Like, as you can see, I don't have much notes. I don't write anything down, really. And I bought it, £64. I mean, Karen became a Karen. She did. She was very unhappy. So what did you do that for? And I played it back to her. Well, I felt the Lord tell me. So, but that in your pipe and smoke it, sweetheart. So I bought a whiteboard, a set of pens and a magnetic rubber. And it was all, I left it wrapped up in my office. Also, I'd recently bought a Facebook Marketplace for £20, a leather chair. And they were both in my rectangular garden office. So I said to Sean, I need to show you something. So we got a coffee. We walked down my little garden path into my cabin in the garden. And he did, he actually dropped an F-bomb, because you weren't redeemed then. He went, me. I said, that's my dream. I went, right. I said, I think this is God speaking to you, mate. And he wrote down on my whiteboard, Airborne Soldier, Identity and Injustice. And we spoke for 2 hours. We spoke about how Jesus, when he died on the cross, took your shame and took your guilt and carried your sorrows and yours. And we talked about how he didn't die for mankind, like he'd heard in the army. But actually died for him. And we talked it all through. And we talked about how being a para for 32 years wasn't who he was. That's what he did. But it wasn't his identity. That wasn't who he was. And we talked all these things through for 2 hours. Then we went for a walk in the woods that were outside my house. It's where everyone goes to smoke crack and weed, actually. Often I like a bit of gardening, so I come in feeling fantastic after. And we went for a walk for 2 hours, and then we ended up standing by the bluebells. It's the 25th of April this year. And we're holding hands. And he gave his life to Jesus. And as he gave his life to Jesus, he looked up with tears streaming down his face, and he said something to me I'll never forget. He said, "Carl, I can hear birdsong." And I went, "What do you mean?" Because you always hear birdsong in the woods, right? And he went, "Since I saw my mate get blown up, I've not been able to hear any background noise. I haven't heard birds singing since 2016. And he went, "I can hear the birds singing." It's weeping. Then we went back, still puts a shiver down my spine. We went back to my cabin. And without any instruction, no prompt, he picked up, he actually unwrapped the board rubber. And he wiped the board clean. Just like Jesus wipes your board clean. And without any prompt, he wrote down, "Sean Partridge, Son of God, Father and Friend." That whiteboard still has that written on it. I've not used it from that day. I don't write anything down. I'm lacquering it up. It's going to hang in his workshop in his back garden. He's now one of our volunteers. He baptized me in a hot tub and had a burger. It was a beautiful moment of triumph. I didn't want to put his face up on the screen, these characters, but I'll happily show you a photo of the whiteboard and the day he gave his life to Christ, and he is glowing. The follow-up is, 2 weeks ago, he came into our midweek Bible study, and he was just beaming. And I said, "What's going on?" He said, "Well, they give you all this tools and equipment as psychotherapy to deal with PTSD, and it's helpful," he said, "but it doesn't work at night. At night, you're wide open. And you just get attacked." He said, "Demons attack you at night. That's what they say. Nothing can beat it." He said, "Something happened last night." I said, "What's that?" He said, "I was reliving stuff. I was tossing and turning. And I couldn't sleep. And I was getting feelings of terror and overwhelmed with anxiety." He said, in his words, "This entity appeared in front of me in this dream." And he said, "And all these evil and wicked and terrible thoughts came through this entity. And in his words, became well-being." He said, "And as it hit me, I just felt this love." He said, "I've not felt like that since I got morphine when I got blown up." He said, "I didn't want to wake up." He said, "It's the first time I just felt love. All this horrible stuff just came through this entity and it was love. I went, 'Do you think it was an angel or Jesus?' He went, 'Oh yeah, I didn't want to wake up.' I said, 'How do you feel now?' And he went, 'I feel amazing. Only Jesus. Only Jesus. He is the bread of life.'" It's why in Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 2, Paul says, "I determined to know nothing amongst you except Christ and him crucified. I didn't come to you with eloquence of speech. I didn't come to you with any great learning. I just determined to know Christ and him crucified. And that's all I come to you with." Only Jesus can change your life. Only Jesus can change your destiny. Only Jesus can fix up your problems. Only Jesus can repair the breach in your family. Only Jesus can actually solve your work problems. Only Jesus is going to fix you 10,000 years from now. Nothing else. We are learning at the moment that our economy and everything is built on sand. There is one currency, one of these kind of Bitcoin-type currencies, went from billions last week to nothing. In an instant, RTX or something, just went like that. Jesus prophesied these things. Do not build your life on sand. Place your feet on the rock. That's where joy is. That's where peace is. That's where security is. Nothing else. Honestly, nothing else. Put your faith in Christ. God bless you.
There's always somebody who has to follow Carl on a Sunday. You've heard the truth this morning. I hope it's stirred your hearts. I hope it's encouraged you. I hope it's challenged you with what we hold in our hands. If you've not met Jesus for yourself, if there's people here this morning, we'd encourage you to speak to one of us with a lanyard on today, because we'd love to talk to you. I'd love to share with you what Jesus has done for us and what he can do for you. So I just encourage you to do that. We're going to sing now and give thanks to Jesus for the truth, for the promises, for the hope that he brings. Let's stand, church.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from the throne of endless glory to a cradle in the His blood, in his name, in his
just in this moment now, I would encourage you this morning just to ask the Lord, is there somebody who needs to hear that you know that needs to hear what Carl has shared this morning? Is there somebody you know that needs to be told about Jesus? I'm going to pray for courage for us people. For courage, for His Spirit, that we might be bold enough to speak the truth. So Father, would you challenge us again, each one of us? Would you draw faces to mind? Would you draw lives to mind that we know need a touch from the Lord? Father, we give you courage and conviction again today. Push us on, Lord, that we might share the hope and the truth of the resurrected Jesus. If you'd like to know Jesus this morning and you don't know Him yet, then please just have a word with one of us with one of these badges on. There'll be some of us hanging around the front. There'll be others in the foyer out there. Just let us know. This afternoon, Alpha's running its Holy Spirit today on Alpha. There are 5 people just doing that today, just wanting an encounter with God. So if you're praying today, pray for those folk as they journey with the Lord. If you want to come tonight and you haven't signed up, I think the sign up might have closed online. Just come anyway, and we're going to have a great time. And there's some nibbles, some fun, and some just challenging there this evening. So come along 7:30 and we'll see you then. Let's greet one another. Let's say a blessing over one another, shall we? So no blessing, then numbers known. So may the Lord Jesus Christ. Actually, can we get up on the screen, Jen? Do you mind? Because I don't think everyone's looking at me as if I'm nuts. Yeah, or anyone will do. Grace of God. Let's have the grace then. That'll do. There we go. Let's do that one. Let's speak to one another, people. Let's look at each other. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you evermore. Amen. Amen.